Hello and welcome to Jeremy's IT Lab. In this video, we'll cover another feature in the STP Toolkit. This time, the focus is rootguard. As the name implies, rootguard guards the root bridge of the LAN, ensuring that another switch with a lower bridge ID can't take over the role. It's typically used when connecting your switches to someone else's switches that you don't have direct control over. For example, if a service provider connects their switches to a customer's network, the provider might want to ensure that the root bridge remains in the service provider's network, and rootguard can help with that. Let's get started. Here's what we'll cover. This is the third video in the STP Toolkit section of this course. We've already covered portfast, BPDU guard, and BPDU filter in the previous few videos. And now we're moving on to rootguard, which prevents a port from becoming a root port by disabling it if superior BPDUs are received, thereby enforcing the current root bridge. As I mentioned in the intro, this can be very useful when connecting your LAN to another LAN that you don't have direct control over. There's also one more feature in the toolkit that you need to know for the CCNA, loopguard. We'll cover that in the next video. So, why is it important to ensure that a specific switch remains the root bridge? Before we look at root guard, let's see why it's valuable. As you know, STP prevents loops by electing a root bridge, that switch 1 in the network above, and ensuring that each other switch has only one valid path to reach it. In this network, switch 2 has one active path to reach switch 1, the direct connection between switch 2 and switch 1. And same for switch 3. Only its direct link to switch 1 is active. The link between switch 2 and switch 3 is disabled to prevent loops. Any of these three switches could be the root bridge, and STP would fulfill its role of preventing loops. But you shouldn't randomly select the root bridge. Good placement of the root bridge is important, and some things you should consider are optimal traffic flow. For example, you should try to minimize latency and congestion in the LAN. Latency just means how much time it takes traffic to travel through the LAN. And congestion refers to how busy the network is. If you try to pump too much water through a small pipe at once, it's not going to be very efficient. And the same principle applies to network connections. So with that in mind, why did I select switch 1 as the root bridge for this LAN? Well, in most LANs like this, the PCs, like those connected to switch 2 and switch 3, don't communicate with each other very much. Usually, they want to communicate with servers outside of the LAN, over the internet, over the wide area network, the WAN, etc. So, we want to ensure that the PCs have an efficient path to reach R1, their gateway to the outside world. And that's why I selected switch 1 as the root bridge. Traffic from hosts connected to switch 2 takes the switch 2 switch 1 link. And traffic from hosts connected to switch 3 takes the switch 3 switch 1 link. This is the most efficient path for each host's frames to reach R1. Another consideration when selecting the root bridge is stability and reliability. Once you select a root bridge that provides an efficient path for traffic in the LAN, you want that switch to remain up and operational for as long as possible. So, if you are using multiple kinds of switches in the LAN, one of the more advanced and reliable switches should be the root bridge. For example, if you only have enough budget to buy a couple of new switches, and the rest of them are old junkers you found in the closet, you should make one of the new switches the root, as you can probably rely on it not to die out after a few weeks of operation. So, those are a couple of considerations when selecting the root bridge: optimal traffic flow, and stability and reliability. Let's focus on the first one, and see what happens if we make a different switch, the root bridge. Now switch 3 is the root bridge. What's wrong with that? Traffic from hosts connected to switch 3 takes the same path, but traffic from switch 2's hosts now has to travel from switch 2 to switch 3, and then from switch 3 to switch 1 before reaching R1. This adds a bit of latency, as the frames are taking a less direct path. But to be honest, that's negligible in most cases, probably less than a millisecond. The true issue is that there could be congestion on the switch 3 switch 1 link if the network is busy. When a link is congested, frames have to wait their turn to be transmitted, and in the worst case, some frames might be dropped, and that could seriously affect network performance and user experience. No one likes a slow network. So, the point is that root bridge selection is important, And after we've selected a root bridge, we usually want it to remain stable. Let's expand the network to show how rootguard is useful. Within your own LAN, you can easily control the root bridge by setting its priority to 0. For example, here is switch 1's bridge ID. The priority is 0, plus 1 for the VLAN ID. Remember, Cisco switches run PVST+, so they always add the VLAN ID to the priority. Assuming switch 2 and switch 3 have the default priority, this makes switch 1 the root bridge. And for the three switches on the right, we'll do the same for switch 6, making it the root bridge for its LAN. However, there are cases where you might connect your LAN to other switches outside of your direct control. For example, maybe the LAN on the left is controlled by a service provider, and the LAN on the right is controlled by a customer. This is one example where switches controlled by different organizations might be connected, a service provider offering Metro Ethernet services to customers. Metro Ethernet isn't something you have to study for the CCNA exam, but it's often used to connect sites within a MAN, a metropolitan area network, such as connecting offices within the same city. So what happens when the service provider and customer connect their networks in this example? Well, switch 2 and switch 3 will send BPDUs saying that switch 1 is the root bridge. But switch 4 and switch 5 will also send BPDUs saying that switch 6 is the root bridge. So who is right? Which switch becomes the root bridge? Switch 1 and switch 6 each have the same bridge ID up to this point, a priority of 1 and a MAC address starting with 5254001. But the next digit for switch 1 is A, and the next digit for switch 6 is 8. So switch 6 has a lower bridge ID. And that means it will become the root bridge. So the lesson here is that even if you set your root bridge's priority to 0, its role can be taken by another switch with a lower MAC address, like switch 6 in this case. So with no safeguard in place to enforce switch 1 as the root bridge, switch 1, switch 2, and switch 3 all accept switch 6 as the root bridge, affecting the service provider's STP topology. Both the switch 1, switch 3 link and the switch 2, switch 3 link are disabled. So frames from switch 3 to switch 1 must take a detour through the customer's LAN. This is obviously not an efficient traffic path, but rootguard can be used to avoid a situation like this. Rootguard can be configured to protect your STP topology by preventing your switches from accepting superior BPDUs from switches outside of your control. And a superior BPDU is a BPDU with superior parameters when it comes to the STP algorithm. For example, a BPDU that claims a better root bridge ID. Switch 6's BPDUs claim a lower root bridge ID than switch 1's, so switch 6's are superior. So if you want to ensure that the root bridge remains in your LAN, you can configure rootguard on the ports connected to switches outside of your control. We're looking at this example from the perspective of the service provider. So that means switch 2 G02 and switch 3 G02, which are connected to the customer switches. The command to enable rootguard on a port is spanning tree guard root in interface config mode. Unlike portfast, BPDU guard, and BPDU filter, there is no command to enable it by default from global config mode. You can only configure it in interface config mode. Now that rootguard is enabled on switch 2 and switch 3's G02 ports, what happens when they receive BPDUs from switch 4 and switch 5, claiming that switch 6 is the root bridge? If a rootguard-enabled port receives a BPDU, it will enter the broken, root inconsistent state, effectively disabling it. We'll examine what those terms mean when we look at the CLI of these switches, but basically, this means that the port won't be able to forward frames and will discard any frames it receives. All traffic is cut off. And switch 1, switch 2, and switch 3 won't accept switch 6 as the root bridge. So even though the service provider and customer LANs are physically connected, they can't communicate. Before moving on, I want to point out that switch 2 G02 and switch 3 G02, as well as the ports they connect to on switch 4 and switch 5, are all designated ports. Normally, there can only be one designated port per link, but in this case, the switches disagree on who the root bridge is. Just remember that in a normal functional spanning tree LAN, there should only be one designated port per link. But this is a special case, because rootguard is blocking the link. Okay, rootguard prevented the customer from influencing the service provider's STP topology, solving the problem for the service provider. But that also means the customer can't communicate over the service provider's network. How can we fix this? To re-enable a port disabled by rootguard, you must solve the issue that disabled the port. In other words, the disabled port needs to stop receiving superior BPDUs. To stop the superior BPDUs, the service provider should tell the customer to increase the priority of their switch. So the customer increases switch 6's priority to 4096 plus 1 for the VLAN ID, and then what happens? Once the superior BPDUs received by switch 2 and switch 3 age out, the ports will automatically be re-enabled. And how long does that take? Well, as you already know, a BPDU's max age is 20 seconds by default. So it should take about 20 seconds, and then switch 2 and switch 3 G02 should be re-enabled. And not only will they be re-enabled, but also switch 4, switch 5, and switch 6 will finally accept switch 1 as the root bridge. And the final STP topology might look something like this. Switch 1 is the root bridge, all other switches have one active path to reach switch 1, and the remaining links are blocked. So the point to remember here is that to re-enable a port that has been disabled by rootguard, you don't have to do anything in the CLI of switch 2 or switch 3, the switches using rootguard. You just need to stop the superior BPDUs, and then the disabled ports will automatically recover. In this case, the service provider told the customer to modify their switch's bridge ID, and then the issue was fixed. Since rootguard only needs a single command to configure it, there's not much to show in the CLI. But let's rewind a bit and look at that process once more in the CLI. So once again, switch 6's STP priority is 1, making its bridge ID superior to switch 1's. I enabled rootguard on switch 2 G02 with the command spanning tree guard root. I'm only showing switch 2's CLI here, but I did the same on switch 3 too. After issuing the command, a message is shown saying that rootguard has been enabled on the port. So what happens when switch 2 and switch 3 receive BPDUs from switch 4 and switch 5? As this log message says, rootguard blocks the ports. Take a look at the output of show spanning tree. G02's status column says BKN, and on the right it says root inc. BKN means broken, and root inc means root inconsistent. A broken port is basically disabled. It can't forward or receive data frames. And root inconsistent tells us why the port is broken. It was disabled by rootguard. Let's fix that problem by asking the customer to increase switch 6's priority, which is now 4097. After about 20 seconds, switch 2 shows a message saying that G02 is now unblocked. And as you can see here, its status is no longer broken, and the root inconsistent message is gone. So the network once again converges with switch 1 as the root bridge. Before we move on to summarize this video, I just want to clarify where you should configure rootguard. Switch 1, switch 2, and switch 3 belong to a service provider, and they want to ensure switch 1 remains the root bridge. A customer's switch shouldn't disrupt the STP topology by becoming the root bridge. Therefore, rootguard is configured on the ports connecting to customer switches, like switch 2 G02 and switch 3 G02. However, note that you shouldn't always configure rootguard on every port connected to another network. For example, while the customer switches connect to the service provider, the customer shouldn't configure rootguard on their own ports. If the customer configures rootguard on switch 4 and switch 5's ports that connect to the provider, those ports will just be disabled if they receive superior BPDUs, blocking those links. And there's no point in connecting to a service provider if you can't communicate over their network. Okay, let's summarize rootguard. When selecting a LAN's root bridge, you should consider a few things, such as optimal traffic flow that minimizes latency and congestion, as well as the stability and reliability of the switches. The root bridge plays a key role in the spanning tree, so it shouldn't be a random decision. Within your own LAN, you can easily control the root bridge by setting its priority to 0. And if you have direct control over all of the switches in the network, there's no need to configure root guard. But there are cases where you might connect your switches to other switches that are outside of your control. The example we used in this video was a service provider switches connecting to a customer switches, which might happen when the service provider is offering Metro Ethernet services, for example. Root guard can be configured on specific ports to prevent them from accepting superior BPDUs from other switches. For example, a service provider switches generally shouldn't accept superior BPDUs from a customer switches. You can use spanning tree guard root to enable root guard on a port, and there is no command to enable it by default from global config mode. Portfast can be enabled by default because in most cases, you want to enable it on all access ports because they usually connect to end hosts. And BPDU guard and filter can be enabled by default on all portfast enabled ports because those features are often used together. But root guard isn't the kind of feature that you want to enable on ports by default. It should only be enabled on specific ports where needed, and that's why it can't be enabled in global config mode. And what exactly does root guard do? It prevents a port from becoming a root port if it receives a superior BPDU. Instead, the port status will be broken and root inconsistent. Basically, broken means the port is blocked, it can't forward frames. And root inconsistent tells us why it is broken, because root guard blocked the port. But if the port stops receiving superior BPDUs, it will automatically recover. You don't need to manually re-enable the port, or use air disable recovery like with BPDU guard. Okay, that's all for this video on root guard. I hope it was helpful. Thanks for watching. Before finishing this video, let me thank my JCNP level channel members, who support me through YouTube channel membership. To become a member, please click the join button under the video. Thanks to Jonathan Makara, Velva Jacob, George, Nasir Chaudhary, Gustavo Macedo, Marcel Lord, Dragos Hernea, Zakib Shah, Mayor Salman, Vitaus194, Mark Jackson, Bold1C1U, Gerald Guillaume, Fristos1207, Hector Hernandez, Arpad Conives, 5 Feet, Owad Daniel Brown, Jose Alvarez, Hussein Yavuz, Samuel Tavares, Roger Bratseth, Kevin Hayes, Brian Grant, Georgi Gemajev, Cats for Life, Addison Pereira, Farad69, Madmark 50484, Alexander Stratan, Hiago Bicalho, DMJ2, Lucien Stoichitoyu, Kurt Nell, Steve Cox, Jasper Yim, Pedro Hartman, Tricky Mickey 123456, Ivano Capuano, Jefferson Steelflex, Toxic, Wilmer Romero, Sinan Sarisinar, Daniel Andrade, Dragos George, Jairo Francisco, Philip Jovanovic, Trevor Goldman, Sunny Idigu, Jeffrey C., Edificare, Dimitra Lise, Mikhail Chapsky, Hemanth Jabalpuri, Dariush D., Juan Morales, Gonzalo Nicolas, Doomed Soul, Christine Schubert, Julio Maya, Egreso, Komlan Kapedimi, Hashem Rodef, Anand Abiyankar, Adekola Ismail Salami, Clyde Mkorobindo, Orlando Flores, Adrian Martinez, MD Danielwitz, Prashanth M., Ray Enriquez, GG7, Tobe Hedin, Arturo Ray Mejia, Vic, Brandon Byers, MDS Electronar Zedja, Raymond Kirby, G. Gant, Henrietta Sauer, Yusuf Tassaten, Pablo Gauto, Omar Abdel Fattah, Yuk Shika, Furkan Yalsin, Uma Shankar Sharma, Philip Creighton, Vishal Bansal, and 12062 Alfred. Sorry if I pronounced your name incorrectly, but thank you so much for your support. Thanks to you and my other supporters, I am able to make these videos and release them for free on YouTube, so I really appreciate the support. Another great way to support the channel is to like the video, leave a comment, subscribe, and most importantly, share this video with others. So if this video was helpful, I'd appreciate it if you did any of those. Thanks for watching. Thank you.